What's going on, all my healthcare brothers and sisters? I hope that y'all are having a wonderful day. It is finally here. You've been requesting it, and I am finally videotaping it. It is the updated How to Pass Your Pediatric Advanced Life Support Certification Like a Boss. So we're going to be doing the How to Pass Your Pediatric Advanced Life Support series a little bit differently than we did the original video in 2017. On the original video, I had a lot of people ask, it's not as in-depth as it should be. There's no mega code. Where's the mega code? I need mega code. You said mega code, but there's no medical code. So we're going to be doing it a little bit differently. I decided to put it over a series of videos versus just doing one video, because just one video would be way too long and I feel like you would be aggravated for a 45 minute video about pediatric advanced life support. So we're gonna be doing a little bit differently. So this specific video, we're gonna be talking about understanding BLS and the PALS certification. So pediatric advanced life support certification can be stressful. Whether you're taking the examination for the first time or you're renewing it after having not taken it 2 years ago, here are some helpful tips in passing the PALS certification examination like a boss. So the definition of neonate, infant, child, and adolescent. A neonate is defined as 0 to 28 days. An infant is 28 days to 1 year. A child is greater than 1 year old but has not reached puberty. And an adolescent is when puberty is present, either through armpit hair or breast development. So in basic life support, we follow the CAB sequence of cardiopulmonary resuscitation, compression, airway, and breathing. We want to first verify that the scene is safe, and we want to check for responsiveness and get help. You want to verify the scene is safe so that you don't become a victim yourself. Check for responsiveness of the child, tap the shoulders or the heel of an infant, and shout, "Are you okay?" And I'm not talking about just a little, "Are you okay?" I'm talking about, "Are you okay?" That's what I'm talking about. If the victim doesn't respond, and if there is help nearby, you want to activate the emergency response system. However, if no one responds, do not leave the child. Perform at least one round of CPR prior to going and finding help. That's extremely important. Next, we want to assess for our breathing. No more than 10 seconds. We want to check for rise and fall of the chest and if there is a pulse present. Pulse checks on infants, we want to palpate the brachial pulse. And on a child, we're going to palpate either the carotid or the femoral pulse. The child is unresponsive, has no pulse, and is not breathing, we're going to start CPR immediately. So in an infant, we do 2-finger chest compressions, center of the chest at the nipple line. One person rescuer is going to be 30 chest compressions to 2 breaths. 2-person rescuer is going to be 15 chest compressions to 2 breaths. It's better for coronary perfusion as part of the PALS guidelines. For a child or an infant, depending on how big they are, we then can either do one-handed or two-handed CPR technique. Chest compression should be 1/3 the AP diameter of the chest. So in infants, that's 1.5 inches or 4 centimeters. Children, that's 2 inches or 5 centimeters. No compressions should go beyond 6 centimeters. 100 to 120 chest compressions per minute in infants, children, and adolescents. Let's talk about rescue breaths. After every 30 chest compressions, the provider should provide 2 breaths over 1 second. You want to see the chest rise and the chest fall to confirm appropriate rescue breaths. Patients should be placed in the sniffing position for optimization of rescue breathing. This requires the flexion and extension of the head and the neck using the EC method on the bag mouth vest. Next, let's talk about AED placement on infants and children. Under 8 years of age, use child pads if they are available. If child pads are not available, you may use the adult pads in the kit. Place pads so that they don't touch each other. One is placed on the front of the chest and the other is placed on the back of the child. Pads should sandwich the heart when placed appropriately. 8 years of age or older, you use the adult pads. Do not use the child pads. It's very important. They will likely not give the amount of shock that is needed to resuscitate that child. If the child has a pulse but is agonally breathing, you do not need to give CPR. You do, however, want to give rescue breaths over 1 second every 3 to 5 seconds. IV and IO access on children is hard. IO access is actually the preferred access for cardiac arrest in pediatric over IV access because it's the quickest. Lastly, let's talk about understanding the difference between synchronized cardioversion versus defibrillation and PAL certification. So defibrillation is the treatment for immediate life-threatening arrhythmias in which the child does not have a pulse, such as ventricular fibrillation or pulsus ventricular tachycardia. Defibrillation, the initial shock is 2 to 4 joules per kilogram. The second shock should be greater than or equal to 4 joules per kilogram. And the maximum amount of shock that you give should not be more than 10 joules per kilogram. It's easy if you remember this mnemonic. 2, 4, 6, 8. That's the dose we defibrillate. Synchronized cardioversion is the treatment that aims to convert an arrhythmia back to sinus rhythm, such as atrial fibrillation or supraventricular tachycardia. So with synchronized cardioversion, we want to do 0.5 to 1 joule per kilogram. I hope this video is helpful for you in passing your PAL certification like a boss. If you're ready to move on, click the video next to me, or until next time, have a great day. Bye!